Sunny days, that the sky above us would never turn gray. But life isn't always sunshine. We have times that leave us asking why. And when the clouds roll in and tears begin,
Without end, in that moment. most blessed, sweet moment when there is a hello after goodbye, a blessed reunion promised in time. He will be with them far longer than we were without, no doubt. No more tears in
He lives, I can face tomorrow because He lives. All fear is gone because I know He holds a future and life is worth the living just because He lives.
God sent His Son, they called Him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds the future and life is worth the living just because He lives.
And then one day
is worth living
just because He lives.
We pray for blessings. We pray for peace, comfort for family, protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, for prosperity. We pray for Your mighty hand to ease our suffering. Spoken need, yet love is way too much to give us lesser things. 'Cause what if Your blessings come through raindrops? What if Your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know Your need? Trials of this life are Your mercies in disguise. We pray for wisdom, Your voice to hear, and we cry in anger when we cannot feel You near. doubt your goodness, we doubt your love, as if every promise from your word is not enough.
made a little note there as I was watching the video. Heaven got a little sweeter just a few days ago, don't you think? And I think we're going to start the service by singing what I believe to be one of Tammy's favorite songs. In all of the texts and notes that I've seen written, there is a phrase all over just about all of them: because he lives, I can face tomorrow. So let's begin our service. If you'd like to, let's stand together and let's just sing. The words are behind me, so let's just sing this good song. God sees his son, they called him Jesus, he came to love, heal and forgive, he lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior. Just because he lives. you so much for helping us. Wanted to welcome our folks that are here by way of live stream. We want to say thank you for the family, for all of you folks that are here today. Just your presence probably speaks way more than what you could ever dream. So we want to thank you for being here for that, and also those that are watching live stream. We are here today to celebrate the honor and memory and life of Tammy Nicole McEldowney. Most of all, we're here to honor our Lord Jesus Christ, and all God's people said. Amen. Tammy was born June the 10th, 1986, here in Ocala. She was born again by the Spirit of God in 1993. She went home to be with the Lord September the 9th, 2020. Tammy was born on June the 10th, 1986, to Kermit and Dorothy McEldowney in Ocala, Florida. She was an educator and an administrator at a Christian preschool. Tammy dedicated her life as a testimony of faith in God to her students, family, friends, beloved nieces and nephews, and everyone she met. She realized in her battle with cancer that her true mission field was to shine the light of Jesus Christ in death. If just one soul is saved by her loss, she would tell you her death was worth it all. I'm going to ask Samuel if he would to pray, and then we'll be seated.
Dear Lord, I want to thank you for salvation, because through salvation we have that eternal hope that we get to see Tammy again. Thank you for the privilege of knowing her. Thank you for the impact that she made on our lives. Lord, we are here with heavy hearts, because we miss this wonderful person and bright light, Lord, in our lives. But we're so thankful for Calvary in the grave, so that like Tammy, our faith we made sight, and we'll get to see you. And we'll get to see Tammy once again. Lord, I pray that you would be with the service. Be with the family, Lord. Be everything that they need. Lord, be their comforter and be their peace. I pray, Lord, that Tammy's desire would be fulfilled today. And that her death and her testimony would not push people away from you, but draw them closer.
Amen.
Anybody that knows her knows that that was her only desire. I pray, Lord, that we would remember Tammy's life as someone who loved God and who wanted everyone to be closer to you. Lord, we love you and are so grateful that we get to be here to worship you and to memorialize Tammy's life. I pray that you would bless the rest of the service, and I pray that everything we do would glorify you and you alone. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
Outside brings me doubt.
what's the truth I need from you to cast this darkness out? My tears are in your bottle. You never lost a drop. I know that strength will follow, and joy will fill my cup. Joy comes with the dawn, tender one, God's own son, keep me by your side. May your past inspire my path, your sweetness be my guide. Give me peace to follow free, free from fear and hurt. May I hear your spirit clear, remind me from your word. My tears are in your bottle. You never lost a drop. I know that strength will follow, and joy will fill my cup. Arise, arise, your spirit cries. The journey was too great, and I, my Lord, feast on your word. Now take me, shape my faith. My tears are in your bottle. I don't need them anymore, 'cause greater things will follow than this world has in store. Joy comes with the dawn. Joy comes from your son.
All I want to say is praise the Lord, Alondra. Some of you may know this. Alondra wrote that song, and I just want to take time to say praise the Lord. Wonderful job. What an incredible ministry to the heart. Yeah, that's good. It's okay. Great ministry. Okay, Brother Bob, why don't we let him sit down on this song, okay?
Okay, if I would direct you, everyone, to look at the screen, we're going to sing "What a Day That Will Be." There is coming a day when no heartache shall come. No more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye. All is praise forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day. Upon his face, Thank you.
Thank you, Brother Bob. A eulogy simply means that that's the time in words that we honor the one who's gone on to heaven before us. And so we're going to take this time right now to do just exactly that, remembering that in part we are here today to honor and celebrate the memory and life of Tammy McEldowney. And I think you're in for a real treat as the family and close friends share their deepest thoughts about their daughter and their friend. And so, Brother Kermit, why don't you come and we'll go ahead and get this started.
I'm sure we all have stories that we could share about Tammy and her life. And we would love to hear those someday. But for me and my wife this morning, we would like to just share you some of our thoughts about Tammy from a parent's perspective. Our journey began with Tammy on that beautiful day of June the 10th, 1986, but precisely at 6:35 p.m. There was my beautiful little girl, Tammy. The way that we spelled her name was T-A-M-M-Y. Sometime later, she became fond of the new spelling, T-A-M-I, and it was okay with me, but it became a term of endearment between her and I that I would intentionally mispronounce her name, and I would call her Tam-I. As many of you know, Tammy could not speak without using her hands. And there was a period of time where she wanted to learn sign language so that she could minister to the deaf. The problem for Tammy was a deaf person watching her would become very confused because the motions that she had as she was speaking, it wasn't part of the national sign language. Tammy had a creative mind. She was always interested in medicine, and therefore a time we thought maybe the Lord was calling her into the medical profession. She liked to watch programs on television, trauma, life in the ER, and my wife will recount two stories about Tammy. The first one being when Marissa was in the hospital for an operation.
Marissa, I think she was about 8 years old, needed to get a hernia operation. And I was holding my baby girl for a while. I had to go to the bathroom. So Tammy took her, which Tammy was like her second mother, she thought, took control very quickly on that situation. And when I came back in, Tammy still had Marissa in her arms. And when the nurse and the doctor came in, they looked, "Oh, isn't that nice? Your mom and your grandma are here." And I've never lived that down. So I took my baby back and I said, "No, she's my baby. That's her sister." And the nurse and everybody, of course, Marissa and Tammy, never let me live that one down. So that's when I went to dye my hair. Also, one time we went up to St. Augustine for a family vacation, and Tammy and I were in the car following Kermit in the motorhome, and Marissa didn't like to sit in the seats like she should, and consequently, she went to climb up on the top of this part of the motorhome, and she fell and she got hurt and cut her arm pretty good. So Stephen goes, "Dad, Marissa cut her arm." And he says, "Well, how bad is it?" "Well, I see the muscle." "Okay." So he pulls over. I'm thinking, okay, what's going on, you know? And he goes, "You need to go check on Marissa." Oh, my stars. I saw, was like, okay. So we went to the doctors, and of course, Tammy had to go with me because that's what she loved, and she loved that shoulder, was the coolest thing. So we went to the doctors, and as they're stitching up Marissa, they're taking the needle and they're numbing her arm, and then they stuck their finger in there to make sure there was no debris and stuff like that in there. My strong little daughter that loved this stuff went, nope, she fell straight to the ground. So I had to run around to the other side and get Tammy. And I says, "What happened to you?" So we talked about the way how she said, "Don't you ever tell anybody I did that."
She had a creative mind, even liked playing doctor with her siblings and the neighborhood friends. And in her creativity, she would take sandwich baggies and would make IV bags out of them, connect them with a piece of yarn as the IV tube, and then she would use real straight pins as a needle, literally poking her friends and family. And but the funniest one that I would like to tell you is she had convinced her brother to go along with pretending that he had a broken leg. And in her imagination, she convinced him to put on a pair of ladies' pantyhose. And then her and I think it was Eva or somebody was wheeling Stephen around in like a push cart, pedal cart. And everything was going fine. They were pretending like they were on the field, you know, rushing the patient to get help, and along goes two of the neighborhood boys seeing Stephen on his cart wearing a lady's pantyhose. They started humiliating him, and he jerked them off, and he was done playing. Thanks for the memory, Stephen. Tammy had there was a word that she used with me very often, and it come to mean many things. If she was trying to ask for my help for something, maybe something was wrong with the car or something at the house was going wrong, I would ask her to describe it to me. And the best that she could do was, well, it's that thingy. It's that thingy. So thingy was a word that she used quite a bit that it meant many things. Tammy loved, she loved cheese and she loved tomatoes. And she hated onions. So when we would go out to eat at a restaurant, one day she saw me, because I love cheese and onions, or cheese and tomatoes as well, and I had requested extra cheese and extra tomatoes on my salad. Well, she thought that was the neatest thing ever, and so from that day forward, when her and I would go out to a restaurant, she was sure to emphasize to the waitress or the waiter that when we said extra, we would request a bowl of onions and a bowl of cheese.
Tomatoes.
It became a joke between her and I that we would try to see which one of us could take the most tomatoes. Tammy loved the mountains. She loved the beach. She liked going on cruises. She loved her church. She loved singing in the church. She loved her friends, her family. She loved her dog, Dixie. But most importantly, she loved God. She was ministry-minded in every aspect of her life, and she liked helping and sharing people to encourage them. And she was most definitely an uplifting person. As you saw in some of the pictures there, where she was trying to get Daddy to smile, I was having one of those days. And you just weren't allowed to be unhappy around Tammy if she could help it. She had a way of putting a smile on your face. She desired to become a missionary's wife. And I stand before you today wearing a tie that when she went down to a ladies' conference, Mom was there, I guess, with her. And they had encouraged her to pick out a tie for her husband-to-be and to pray over that, for the Lord to lead her the right man. And so this hung in her closet
by her bed.
And she prayed over that, just waiting patiently on the Lord to send the right guy her way. She really wanted to be a missionary's wife. She remained faithful in that waiting. And along the way, she would get letters and calls of encouragement. And one such letter came on August the 10th of 2016, which I found this in her Bible. And I remember the day she got this letter. She was so happy that this gentleman, who she dearly was fond of at her college, Alton Beale, president of Ambassador Baptist College, she came out to me and she says, "Dad," she says, tears in her eyes, she says, "look what I got." And I'm only going to read you part of it, but I want to highlight some things that he said that was such an encouragement to her and why she cherished this and kept it in her Bible. He says, "Dear Tammy, it was great to see you this past weekend. Your joyous countenance is sure to bring a glimpse of happiness to any soul. I am so glad to see that God is using you to make a difference in young lives. You have a gift that I do not have. I can handle junior age kids, but that's as low as I go." And then he goes on to say, "Be sure to stop by when you come up to visit in this area. I thank the Lord for the ministry that he has given you, and am praying that the young man who is supposed to marry you will find you soon. In the meantime, you keep a fervent heart for the Lord and desire him more than anything or anyone. He always satisfies." He signed it under his wings, Alton Beale, president. I found, as I was going through Tammy's Bible, she had lots of stuff in her Bible, and since her passing, I have kept her Bible by my bedside, and like last night when I can't sleep, I just like looking through it. Little notes that she's written in there, they minister to Dad. But I just would like to share some of these words that she had penned out. This is dated back in 2013, long before she ever got sick. And she titled it, "Stay in the Castle." And I'm sure that it had to do with a message that she heard. She has several verses on the back. But she highlighted some things, and she took her ink pen, and she just boldly wrote over that to make it as bold as she could. And she put a star by it. And the first one here, it says, "Don't ever stop waiting on God's will." She says, "Wait on the Lord and in his timing," and she puts in parentheses, "not mine. All things will work together for good." And then later on this page, she says, "Never stop waiting for the right man," exclamation mark. She says, "God has a plan for my life, and he will bring us together in his timing, not mine. She says, I need to trust the Lord as Joseph trusted him. And some of the verses that I have seen where she has penned them in multiple writings, they keep repeating themselves. This one here was Hebrews 11:6, where she says, but without faith, and she circled faith, it is impossible, underlines that, to please him. And Pastor, she has beside this, you must have preached a message on January 25th of 2014, because she wrote a reference to that. And then one of the other verses on this side, she says, Romans 8:28, and we know that all things work together for good to them that love God. And then at the very bottom, she says, I am willing to let Jesus write my love letter. She was determined to achieve. Even while she was going to college at Ambassador Baptist College, which began in 2007, a lot of you may not know, but she never finished receiving the degree that she set out to achieve. But she struggled very hard at it. And the only reason why she never finished was because she kept dealing with health issues along the way. I remember her coming home at one time because she was so sick, and we just had to bring her home to just heal. So she got so far behind. But Ambassador Baptist College was such an encouragement to her. And she was able to go back, and she at least persevered to earn her Bible diploma. That was so important to her. We got to go up there and bask in that. And we were looking for her diploma as we were trying to gather the photos and stuff. And she faithfully had it displayed at her little office at her work. My wife's going to tell you about how, even at a young age, how she was such a strong-willed little child.
Since pretty much the day I gave birth to my little girl, she was a very strong young girl. At 2 weeks old, she could put her arm up like this and hold her head up. She was a very determined young girl. And I got very wise counseling from a very dear friend of ours, Roger, who told me, Dorothy, you have to deal with her will. You have to break the will, but don't break the spirit. And then I looked at him and thinking, how do you do that? How do you not beat your kid to death almost? Because she was strong. She was just determined. And I said, how do you do that? He says, you have to pray every day for God's grace. Every day when you get up, before you meet her, you have to pray for God's grace. Okay, fine. So I did. She was about 12 months old. By this time, she was already out of her crib because she had already destroyed it. So I figured, well, I better take her out before we have any more kids and there's not a crib left. So I put her in a little toddler bed, and she came out, and I was folding up clothes on the couch, and she was messing with the TV. We had one of those old-fashioned console TVs, yeah. And I told her, I said, Tammy, please don't touch the TV. Don't touch the TV. Well, she touched it again. I said, Tammy, don't touch the TV. So then Roger kept telling me, don't tell them more than one time. If you mean it, you better back it up. I said, okay, I told her no. That means I got to do it. So I went up there and I smacked her hands. I said, Tammy, don't touch the TV. Touch it. Oh, are you kidding me? Really? So then we went through this for a little while, long while, actually. Spanked her hands. Both of her hands were a little red. Put her in her room. I said, this has got to stop, you know? So we distract her. That's what people tell me. You got to distract them. And I tried that. Nope, didn't work. Right back down that hallway, looked over at me, went back over, looked at the TV. Touched it again. God, are you kidding me? This can't be happening. Finally, the words that Roger put in my head, you have to break this will, not the spirit. I thought, okay, God, I don't know how to do that. How do I do that without really hurting my kid? And God says, you have to really spank her. I said, God, she's only 12 years old. She's a year old. How do you do that to a year old?
12 months.
And God gave me the grace. I did really spank Tammy to the point that she did not cry angry with me no more. And when she quit, and I got that real cry from her, I said, okay, you go in your room and cry? I'm going to go cry in my room. And I did. And it was sweet after that. But he was right. And God's word is right, because that's where I got that from, is you have to train the child in God's way. And with God's grace, I did. I saw Tammy's heart change. She always had a heart. She always cared about everybody. She wants to take care of everybody. But I saw her change after she got saved. And I saw her grow there.
Before you get into that, let me read her.
That's what I saw.
Her salvation. As we were going through Tammy's personal belongings, we found she typed it as her autobiography. And it was something that she was assigned to do in college. But she actually wrote out her testimony. And I just want to read it to you. This is in her own words. She says, "Hi, my name is Tammy Nicole McElDowney. I was born on June the 10th, 1986 in Ocala, Florida, to wonderful parents Kermit and Dorothy McElDowney. I have one brother and two sisters. Their names are Stephen, Michelle, and Marissa. My family is one of my greatest joys in life, but the biggest joy in my life is Jesus Christ, because he died for my sins. I received Jesus Christ as my personal Savior when I was 7 years old. There was something missing in my life, so I asked my dad one night to help me. As we knelt there in our home, I asked the Lord Jesus Christ to come into my heart. Since that night, the Lord has been working continuously in my life. In 2003, while I was attending a youth conference with my church, I gave my life to the Lord full time. The following year, while attending a missions camp, the Lord spoke to my heart about becoming a missionary. So while at camp and later in my home church, I publicly dedicated my life to become a missionary and to go wherever the Lord may direct me. Since then, I have been involved in the church choir, soul winning, visitations, sign language ministries, teaching in junior church, teaching at Vacation Bible School, and working summer camp for 2 years. In the spring of 2007, the Lord directed me to Ambassador Baptist College, where I am currently studying on getting my Bachelor of Christian Education. What I have enjoyed most in life is teaching children about Jesus Christ, spending time in God's Word. I also love to spend time with caring family and friends that God has blessed me with. After attending college, I plan to become a missionary teacher and go wherever the Lord leads me, and maybe one day marry the man God has chosen for me, that together we would serve God according to his plans." Now, my wife will share with you the story about when we truly did see a heart change in Tammy's life, where she was 100% sold out in serving the Lord.
Camp was a big part of Tammy's life, adventure of faith, when she was 13, and Daddy didn't want to let her go. She was too young. And I said, but she needs to go. She really does, and I really believe that's what God wanted her to do. And we convinced Daddy to let her go, and it was the best decision we ever made for our daughter. The teaching, the preaching that she was able to hear helped her in her life choices. And I've taught all my children, be careful of your choices, because they have consequences. And I knew that the choices that my children made when they were young would affect them as adults. And I really tried hard to instill that in them. And at camp, it reinforced that. And Tammy says, "Mom, I don't want to live with regrets when I become an adult. I don't want to do that." And I said, "You have to stay in your word, and you have to grow." She did. And as camp each year, she looked forward to it. And then eventually she became a counselor up there and working with the camp. But she loved working with kids, and she wanted to help kids. Kids that nobody wanted to be around, that most people think are a pain or obnoxious, because Tammy was that way when she was younger. She was a hyper little girl, and everybody used to get irritated with her a lot because Tammy was. She was loud, and she was very hyper. And Tammy didn't want to treat kids and make kids feel that like they weren't loved or that you didn't want to be around them. And she knew how that felt. And she wanted kids to know no matter how you act, God loved them. And she wanted them to see that in her, that no matter what you do wrong, no matter how you live, God always loves you and he'll always forgive you. And that's what she wanted people to see in her.
So, as we move forward in January of this year, the Lord revealed a new chapter in our lives, Tammy's life, when her body was afflicted with cancer. I remember my daughter's been such an encourager to me. And because of the COVID restrictions, I was not able to go up to the hospital. My wife was there with her. So I had to wait at home. And I was at home waiting whenever they came home. And Tammy walks into the front door, and without either one of us saying a word, we just went to each other and embraced. And we hugged for the longest time, and she just kept whispering in my ear, "It'll be okay, Daddy. God's in control." And at that, with those words that I just said of her encouragement to me, I found another handwritten thing in her Bible. And this one's dated June 17th of 2014, long before she ever got her cancer. But this goes to show you how firmly anchored she was in her faith. I won't read the whole thing. I'm just going to read the one that really spoke to me. She starts off by quoting Hebrews 11:1. She wrote, "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen." And she goes on to say, "Trust in the Lord with all thine heart. Lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths." And in her thoughts, she says, "No matter how hard it is, I know my God is right beside me, holding my hand, and everything will be okay. No matter what trial comes into my life, my God is already there and ready to help me get through it. All I need to do is reach out my hand and trust him." And then she starred this next line. She says, "Please, dear Jesus, help me to keep my eyes on you and help me to never quit, even though I don't understand why or what is the reasoning for this trial. My heart longs to please you and to be the godly woman you want me to be." And then on the back, one of the psalms that she wrote, Psalms 27:14, she says, "Wait on the Lord, be of good courage, and he shall strengthen thy heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord." So Tammy's faith has become a testimony of strength for certainly my whole entire family, for me as dad, my wife as mom. And it's our faith that has carried us through this difficult time. And it's our faith that helps take some of the pain away from missing our daughter. She was always praising the Lord for answered prayers and his blessings, even during this trial that she was in the midst of. And One day I asked her, I says, "Tammy," I said, because we were talking about all of the many things that the Lord has done. And I said, "Have you thought about writing these down?" I says, "Because it would sure be an encouragement to the church to just stand before them and just to lift our hands in praise for what the Lord has done in your life." And even though he hasn't sought the outcome the way we would like to have had the outcome, we can still praise and worship him for his goodness. And I just received a card in the mail yesterday from a good family friend, and to my surprise, they were out of town. As far as I knew, they were up in Michigan or someplace. And he likes to write poems. And you may notice there's a candle out back where somebody had given to the family. And he titled his poem, A Candle. It says, "A candle on earth will shine no more, but now it shines bright on another shore. We have the assurance, if we believe, that life everlasting is ours to receive. For those who remain at this time, there is faith and confidence that all will be fine. God has prepared a wonderful place for everyone who is saved by his grace. Heaven is that place God has prepared, so all can look forward and not be scared. When our meeting takes place on heaven's shore, there will be love, joy, and peace forevermore." Dennis J. Robson. Thanks, Dennis. So, one more bit of testimony on behalf of Tammy. She liked to doodle. And this is a beautiful card that she doodled some pictures on here to go with some verses. And the one that touched me the most was on the back, but let me just start by saying she titled this Wait. And she put a clock up there. She drew a clock. Wait on the Lord. Psalms 37:34. And Isaiah 40:31, she says, "But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength." And then she wrote, "He has a perfect plan." And then she wrote, "Am I willing to let him finish painting his perfect picture for me?" And she painted a little picture down here. And then on the back, she says, "I can't see the future, but he can. And he knows exactly what I need and just the right time that I need it." And the little doodle that she did here, she drew a bottle. And she has the word "me" inside of that bottle with the word "world" outside of the bottle. And she has the word "Holy Ghost" indicating the bottle. And then below that she says, "Is my inward pressure greater than the outward pressure of this world?" And she just simply says, may I walk with Christ. Our family would like to just extend our gratitude. Your kindness has been very overwhelming. Your prayers have been sweet and welcomed. And I would ask you to continue praying for us, even in the weeks and months ahead. Let's pray. Father, Lord, I thank you for your salvation, for your mercy and your grace. And Lord, I thank you for blessing us with Tammy, Lord, my little girl. Lord, I thank you for giving us 34 years that we could share in laughter and in tears. Lord, trials and triumphs. I pray, Lord, that you would take the testimony of her life, and Lord, you would continue to use it in a marvelous way to continue reaching others for Christ. Lord, Tammy's testimony, Lord, it was strong and it was real. And Lord, the love she had to serve you and to serve others. Lord, may we as parents, may we continue going forward, living for you, holding on to our faith, trusting in your word. Lord, that as the devil would try to take our weakness and cause us to fail, Lord, we know that the Lord can take those very weaknesses and make us strong. And so, Lord, we know that you've brought us through this trial. We may not understand it, but Lord, we trust you that your will is perfect. And Lord, that we will see greater things in the days ahead, Lord. I pray that you would bless everyone that's here today. Lord, I pray that, Father, that everybody would remain safe, Lord, from COVID, and Father, that we could just go away from here, Lord, feeling challenged and refreshed, hearing and sharing Tammy's testimony. And Lord, as Pastor shares from the Word of God, Lord, I just pray that you would take your word, that you would magnify it, that it would reach hearing ears, that it would penetrate open hearts, that, Lord, our lives could be changed. And, Lord, that everything that we say and do, that we'll continue to give you the praise and the glory. Amen.
Special friend to the McEldowney family, Brother Roger Walton, who now lives in Western North Carolina, I believe, and who is now himself fighting bone cancer, would certainly, if he could, be here today to make this contribution to the service. But instead, he can't be, and so, Roger, if you're watching, I hope I do your contribution justice. In September of 2018, 2 years before Tammy went home to be with the Lord, Roger says, Tammy drove her car and Dorothy drove the moving van as Melody and I made our way back to live in the mountains of Western North Carolina. In one of our conversations, Tammy asked me to, if I would, write a song that she would love for me to sing at her wedding if the Lord brought someone into her life. I asked her for a theme, and she wanted it centered around the thought of Daddy's little girl. On a very sleepless night, of the 15th into the 16th, the Lord burdened my heart to write the song from the view of her departure to heaven. The words and music were written the morning of September the 16th, 2020, and recorded that afternoon. And Roger says, I pray that it is a blessing to the family. Now, we have not only Roger singing this song, but the words are going to be on the screen so that you can follow, because in his condition, his voice, it sometimes is weak. And but let's go ahead and do that, Samuel, if you're ready.
Thought we'd hung the moon that special day in June, when to our eyes we saw our firstborn child. She was a precious jewel, a very goodly pearl. I looked at her and said, she is Daddy's little girl. Yes, she's Daddy's little girl, heaven's precious pearl. can be there too. Where I am heaven's precious pearl, and I'm still my daddy's little girl. From a strong-willed child she grew, and we were thrilled to say, when she became a child of Christ, one very special day, she was so strong in Christ, and for him gave her life. I watched her life unfurl, saying, she's daddy's little girl. In heaven begun, and in our eyes we see her precious loving life. Her day so quickly hurled, much like the little merle, and though in heaven now, she's still daddy's little girl. I'm still daddy's little girl, heaven's precious pearl, gone home to live in glory, where her life still tells his story of how Christ died for you, so you can be there too. Where I am heaven's precious pearl, and I'm still my daddy's little girl. In heaven's precious pearl, and I'm still my daddy's little
girl. All right. I have been asked to read a letter written by Amy West, a friend of Tammy's. I just want to put out there, I wasn't told I could write a letter, but here's Amy's letter. I specifically remember the very first time I saw Tammy. It was a somewhat chilly January night when we were in college in North Carolina. She and Alicia were visiting my church for the first time, and we were wearing what And they were wearing what was quite possibly the largest brown fur coats I'd ever seen in my life. I just kind of chuckled to myself because it really wasn't that cold. The rest of us were in light jackets. They definitely stuck out like sore thumbs. But Tammy had a smile that just stuck with me and would continue to reappear over the next 13 years. We became fast friends, then roommates, then best friends. And she became an integral part of my life. She was my beach buddy because no one else ever wanted to go with me. And for me and Tammy, it was our happy place. She was maid of honor at my wedding and took care of every detail, from watching me try on dresses to even making sure my skin wasn't dry before walking down the aisle. My hands were so greasy that they just about slipped out of my almost husband's hands at the altar. She picked up on my husband, Chad, like they were brother and sister. She even made fun of me because I was too chicken to ride the roller coasters at SeaWorld and refused to let me live it down. But you know how I know, sorry, my page just stuck, that she really loved me. She so begrudgingly gave up her plush bed so that Chad and I would have a place to sleep when we came to visit. Those of you who knew Tammy well knew how much she loved her bed. sky high with mattress cushions and egg crates, and how much she treasured her sleep. That's true friendship. Through all the good times and the not so good times, her smile never faded. The only times I saw it dim were when she was fussing at me for being the messy roommate because she was such a neat freak. I could never live up to such standards. She would lay out that famous Tammy sass, which everyone loved, until it was pointed at you. Tammy was always my shoulder to lean on, my constant encourager, and my reminder to keep trusting God. I always felt like she was the strong friend. Though I tried to lift her up on days when she was struggling, I never had quite the right words for her and never felt sufficient, but that's because her sufficiency was in Christ. She was never one to say, follow your heart or do what you think is right. Instead, she consistently pointed me to the Lord. Tammy was the friend I'd always hoped for and always prayed for. I don't think there will ever be another friend like her. During our college days, Tammy always loved to sing the chorus, "Bind Us Together, Lord," hand motions and all. It was silly to sing back then, but today it has greater meaning. It is the love of God and our relationship with Him that bind us together in spite of this temporary separation. I am confident in the hope of heaven, and for those of us who know Christ, we can rejoice in the fact that we will see her again someday. No more pain, no more heartache, no more parting, no more goodbyes. So that was from Amy. So now it's my turn. So when I was asked to speak, and I was contemplating what to speak about, we know what a eulogy is. It's where we try to talk about what we think somebody would want us to say about their life. Well, I struggled with this, and I finally realized it's because, based on the conversations I've had with Tammy, she didn't want me to tell you, she didn't want me, some of you she did, like her mom and dad, not me, to tell you about her life. We had some really hard conversations since February, and they were very blunt and very straightforward. And Tammy would stomp her foot and point at me and say, give it to me straight. Now it's all making a little bit more sense now that I know about the whole IV thing and Stephen wearing pantyhose. It's all coming together because I'm the medical person. So we would talk, have these talks. And so what I want to talk to you about is what Tammy wanted you guys to know. And I had no idea that this was God's design when I met Tammy 10 years ago, but I think everything that's happened has led us to right here and what I'm supposed to say to you for Tammy. So Tammy was never the person who traveled the road most taken. She took the one least traveled. So here we go. So Tammy and I started, we've known each other a long time, but in February when she was diagnosed with this cancer, maybe it was in January, I don't know, around that time, she and I started having some hard conversations. And I would come home and I would share some of what we talked about with Joe. And he would look at me and say, why did she tell you that? And I'm like, I don't know, but now I know. I don't feel like I'm violating her trust at this point because I think this is what she wants you to know. We literally, probably about 3 months ago, talked about her funeral. And she could picture her funeral. And she could picture you here. And she had this project she wanted to work on. And she never did it. And she told me all about it. But in that, she would tell me things that she wanted people to get from her having cancer and from her going home with the Lord. She's had an impact on all of us. I imagine if I would ask you to raise your hand in here, if she has impacted your life and you think it's going to last for years and years, most of us would raise our hands. But what she wanted you to know was, it wasn't because of her. It was because of who she had in her. It was God. And that's why I feel like Tammy didn't want me to talk about her life. She wanted me to talk about the God that was in her life. So I want to take a moment and just say, Tammy walked with God. She wanted to be in God's will. She had a personal relationship with God. I remember the day we were sitting in her bedroom going over her biopsy results. And in reality, a doctor hadn't even given her those results. I interpreted them for her. And we were talking, and she said to me, Angie, if God decides to take me home this way, and it's in his will, it's going to be okay. Family, she said that means it's going to be okay for you too. She had a personal relationship with God. She will live with him forever. But because of her influence, some people's spiritual lives will be impacted forever. I would periodically ask Tammy during this journey. We would be texting, sometimes on the phone, sometimes talking face to face. Tammy, how can I specifically pray for you today? What do you need today? I went back looking through my text messages. I went back and replayed some conversations I had with her. There was only one time when she asked for prayer for herself. The rest of the time, it was you guys on the front row. It was your friends, her friends. There was one time, and it was about a week or two before she passed away. She said, I pray that God will give me the strength to endure the rest of this trial and that my family will come out better for it. She wasn't praying for herself even in that. Second Timothy 4:7 says, I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Tammy fought a good fight. She finished her course and she kept her faith. My question is, have you? This is obtainable to all who have a personal relationship with God. She kept her faith right up until her last breath. I know we're sad and I know we're heartbroken. But when the tears begin to slow down and we move a little further away from the emotions of this day, where will your faith be? Will you be on course? Will this event that has made us feel such incredible loss keep us from fighting the good fight? Tammy would not want that. So now I'm going to speak to the family. And what I'm saying to you is Tammy's words. They're not mine. These are conversations I had with her. She doesn't want you to live in a state of sadness. She wanted nothing more than for you to have joy. Joy came to Tammy despite her circumstances. Today that might feel impossible, but God says we can have it. She would tell you it's okay. You laugh, you love, and you have joy. She would want you to know that God's light can shine through you even now. She would not want for any of you to develop bitterness or depression over her homegoing. She would want you to know that she has eternal joy now, and you can experience it too. Now, close friends of Tammy, Tammy would want you to know God and that you to walk with him. She would want you to know that God can and will fill that void you are feeling today. He can use this brokenness of the circumstance to let his light shine through you. He does not want you to live in sadness or loneliness. He wants to fill that void. I can't think of a better way that you could honor Tammy than allowing God to do that for you. Next, I'd like to speak to nieces, nephews, young people who Tammy has influenced, the people who she's taught and befriended over the years. Aunt Tammy or Miss Tammy would want you to carry on what she has taught you so that you can teach someone else one day. She would want you to look back and say, someone special taught me that words matter, kindness matters, how to love matters, and the love of Christ matters. She would not want you to be frustrated over not understanding why this has happened. She would want you to know that God loves you, and he loves her. She wanted you to know that although you miss her, you can carry her in your heart, and she will abide forever in heaven, but also in your heart. Tammy has impacted us all. We all have the ability to impact someone else. I think what she wanted you to know, what happens from this day forward can have an impact on others. How you move through your grief can impact others. Again, moms and dads who were close to Tammy, your children. What you do from this point forward and how you move through this will impact your children. And Tammy loved your kids. And she would want nothing more than how you finish your race to carry on in your children so that they can finish their race well and so that others could finish their race well. And you know what? I can't think of a better missionary. Kermit, you have the tie. You can be that missionary. And I'm not saying you're not, but that's what she wants. She wants you to move forward for God. I already miss her, but I'm so thankful to have known her. It is special. Tammy was special. Because I can't imagine, I know how she impacted my life. I know how she's impacted my husband's life. And I know how she's impacted my children's life, my nieces and nephews' life. It's a special person who can kind of reach across several generations like that. But I'm thankful to have known her and to carry her memory and her testimony in my heart for the remainder of my days. And I'm incredibly blessed to have had those conversations with her. They were hard. Not at the time. Her and I both have a matter-of-fact kind of personality. But I don't know what she did when I left, but I would leave. Sometimes just, bawling. Because we had these hard conversations. But they were sweet. They were sweet. I'm blessed to have had those conversations. It has made me better. And Tammy wants nothing more than her journey with cancer and her living with God in eternity to make you better. Thank you.
Okay, I'm just going to read it. I can't look. I'm just going to read. Tammy was my best friend. She was a best friend to several of you. When we were kids, we would spend hours on the phone talking about what our adult lives would be like. We would buy wedding magazines. One of those pictures you saw of her laying on my bed, or three wedding magazines surrounding her head. We would pick out the gaudiest dresses and the most elegant hairstyles. We had fun together, going to rodeos, going to theme parks, her favorite being SeaWorld. As teenagers, church camp, and youth activities were always a fun time for us to bond and take a million pictures. As life happened, we kept in touch and maintained a bond that words can't describe. Once my daughters were born, Tammy instantly took to them as if they were her own. Her relationship with them will last forever. I remember the day I found out that I was pregnant with twins, and after calling my husband, the next person I called was Tammy. She had joked with me before that I would have twins one day, and I told her that if I did, she could have one, because that could never happen. It wouldn't happen. I'll never forget the scream she let out on the phone when I announced that her wish was coming true. Michelle was there too. I couldn't tell who was who. Of course, I didn't give her one, but she knew they were both hers. They were her nephews. Tammy was with me when the boys were born, and she took pictures of Brayden because he had to go to the NICU, and I couldn't hold him. And she brought me pictures of him because she knew that I would want to see him. She always thought of me ahead of herself. Tammy's laugh was my favorite. Her smile was infectious and would melt your sadness away. God gave her the most beautiful personality, and everyone who met her could feel his light radiating through her smile and her eyes. I have a sign in my living room that makes me think of her. It says, always pray to have eyes that see the best in people, a heart that forgives the worst, and a mind that forgets the bad, and a soul that never loses faith in God. Last Christmas, Tammy gave me a gift. I didn't get her anything, so I felt really bad. Of course, she didn't care about that and just wanted me to open it up. It was a frame that said family, and it had a picture of her and I that we had just taken together. On the back of the picture, she wrote, friends are the family that we choose for ourselves. Love you, girl. Heart, Tammy, December 2019. I'm so thankful for God bringing Tammy and her family into my life. I couldn't have asked for a better sister. In her last few months, Tammy continuously said, God's not done with me yet. When I would try to have those hard conversations with her, she would stop me and say, no, God's not done with me yet. Her hope and faith were so strong that no earthly power could touch it. I told her that even if God took her home, he would not be done with her on this earth. Tammy's love for God and the impact she left on everyone she met proves that God is still using her. Nobody can replace Tammy. Her testimony will live on forever in my heart and the hearts of my family, and I'll cherish the memories we made. I'll always carry her with me until I see her again.
Aunt Tammy was someone I had always looked up to in many ways, and I considered her as my role model, even though she never knew that. I never got to tell her that I had always wanted to be like her in many ways. And she was always the person I would go to when I was having a hard time at home or I wanted to just talk to someone. And she would always give me some scripture verses that would help me get through whatever I was going through. And she would tell me that anytime she needed me, she would be there. Watching her live through the Lord and using in all of her actions were for the Lord, it makes me want to be able to live like that in my own way. And one thing that we did that was kind of special to us, we, for the past two years, I think, we would go to Busch Gardens for my birthday or for Christmas, and we would get there when it opened and we'd stay till it closed. And on the ride home, she looked straight at me the first time we were on our way back, and she goes, you're not going to sleep, or I'll fall asleep, and we're going to go crash off into the ditch on the road. And I said, but you know how I am in long car rides. I always fall asleep. And she's like, we're getting you coffee. And so we would stop by the gas station, and we would get a coffee every time we had left Busch Gardens, and we would just talk the whole way home. And if, even if we didn't talk, we'd still be there for each other on the ride home. And those are some of the moments that I never would give up for anything, because those meant the most to me.
Thinking on this week and the last week, what's been heavy on my mind has been how we go forward. Wednesday night when we lost Tammy and she went to be with the Lord, it felt like our hearts were ripped out, like we'd never be able to move on. But we didn't sleep that night. But we were together in a lot of prayer. And Thursday, when I couldn't sleep Thursday, I had this on my mind and wrote this out to try to carve a path out so that we, like Angie said, we don't wallow in sadness. We've got to keep moving forward. We've got to make this about the Lord and about our life towards Him. So I'll just read. This is the very edited version. It was probably three times as long when I wrote it, so you're welcome. Mourning is instinctual, isn't it? It churns up out of you in volcanic waves or leaks out haplessly against gritted teeth. It needs no reminders. It needs no teachers. It needs no instructions. For mourning can be manifested in wild outbursts of the soul or in thick walls of silence layered over and over with darkness and thoughts. This is the natural path of mourning, automatic and individual. But in all this grief, the heart searches for purpose or meaning. Former passions have been estranged in the wake of this all-consuming loss, and we are left to whisper or scream in the emptiness of our souls. Now what? To say that our family is devastated by Tammy's loss doesn't cut it. Our devastation is equal to our loss. And with a soul as precious, precocious, and bright as Tammy's, our loss is phenomenal. With a face as needed, as familiar, as gorgeous and warmth as Tammy's, our loss is insurmountable. And like Ashley said, no one can ever replace her. So how do we answer that vacuumous groan of now what? I choose to elevate our practice of mourning from the instinctual to the intentional. Intentional mourning, intentional choice in sensational grief. Intentional mourning requires that we learn from Tammy's life so we can somehow go forward with purpose instead of pain. Intentional mourning means trying to finish the work of the soul lost, or in other words, to pick up their torch and brighten your personal corner with its flame. So what was Tammy's work? And how can I carry on the work for a girl so interwoven into the needs of others that she has left a minefield of holes to fill? I really don't know, but this is what I have learned from her life and the best way I know how to carry on her work. When I teach, I will hug my kids. I will believe in them. I will work hard to make it click. I will go above and beyond, like the architect of the enormous milk jug igloo. I will be transparent, and on some days I might have to exclaim at my students, "You must be out of your minds," like Tammy. When I am in church, I will be a servant. I will show up. I will be willing and sweet. I will try to help people understand someone else. And I will always represent truth from Scripture. I will love our bus kids and pray for them. I will encourage and invite. And I will tell people about RU. I will tell people my story, honest and raw, that others might seek my Jesus, like Tammy. When I go about my day, I will reach out to my loved ones, even if I'm tired. I will stop what I'm doing if someone needs a come to Jesus talk. I will try not to sweat it if someone never pays me back. I will include everyone and make them feel special. I will enjoy family games, and I will help clean the kitchen after a big meal. When our kids start getting married, I will work tirelessly to make their weddings beautiful and meaningful, even if I'm going through heartache. I will try to make the holidays fun, and I will try to get everyone to come to Thanksgiving, like Tammy. When I see my nieces and nephews,
I will stop marking them as someone else's baby, and I will hold them tight, work hard to make them giggle, and kiss them like they're mine. I will buy them a ridiculous amount of toys when I have the money. I will photograph them in sunshine and smiles and hang their pictures on my mother's wall. I will try to give them weekends that I wanted for myself. And sometimes I will not do my laundry so I can see them again, like Tammy. When I am suffering, I will shut my mouth. When I get sick, I'll try not to get mad anymore. I will cast down thoughts that look out for me instead of others. I will work hard to get well, but accept it if I don't. I will smile when I don't feel good. I will pray for the people around me during bad circumstances instead of complaining in my head. If I get cancer, I will pray more, and I will try to tell God thank you, like Tammy. When I worship, I will be real. I will not put on airs around people, but just be me. I will read one special verse over and over and over, rather than a whole chapter that falls by the wayside. I will crawl into the lap of my Abba Father and ask him to write my story. And I will make it known that the only way to have certainty in this life is to trust the blood of Jesus Christ for the next, like Tammy. Tammy's light was bright. We are all mourning because there wasn't a soul that Tammy didn't care about his final destination. To mourn her well, we must seek Jesus, and we must seek souls. To mourn her well, we must put Jesus, then others, then you. To mourn her well, we must take up her torch and lay down our lives and just see what happens next. Because intentional mourning represents not an end, but a new beginning.
You know, at this point, there's very little left to cover. So I'm going to share with you a few thoughts that I've had of Tammy, a few memories I have of Tammy. So for those of you who don't know, I am Tammy's most annoying brother-in-law, James. When I first started dating Michelle, I thought for sure I'd have a rough time with Kermit or maybe even Steven, and they'd probably have that talk about dating Michelle. But it never really came. Then I thought maybe it would have to be Mama McEldowney. Little tiny conversation, but nothing really serious. I was kind of surprised at this. I thought I was safe, in the clear, so to speak. I thought I was going to get off easy. One day, while I was picking up Michelle for a date, I believe it was, Tammy walked out to my truck. She told me if I ever laid hands on, disrespected, or mistreated her sister, I would have to deal with her. At first, I found this somewhat laughable, but then she leaned in towards me and said, "You can hide, but I can still find you." And if you were close to Tammy at all, you knew she was serious. She then gave me that infectious smile everyone talks about, patted me on the shoulder and said, "Have a great time." And she walked away. In case you haven't guessed it yet or seen it, Tammy was like a mother hen to all of her siblings, always watching, always protecting. I soon became one of those protected, and I'm so honored to have called her my family, my sister too. Even though Tammy struggled a little bit with me taking her sister away, as she called it, Tammy still made me feel a part of the family every way she could. Soon after entering the family, she and I had built a strong friendship that I wouldn't have traded for anything. Almost for 2 years now, my wife and I have been living with Tammy and my mother and father-in-law for unseen circumstances. At first, I struggled with this a lot, and I personally felt like a failure. But now, looking back, I am beyond thankful to have been able to have that personable time with Tammy. You see, I can barely see what I'm reading. Right now, she'd probably tell me to suck it up and keep reading. Yeah. Tammy became the sister that I never had. When she saw me struggling, she was sure to stop and pray with me and always gave me one of her infamous hugs. I can't begin to tell you the many times I would receive a text from her just saying that she was thankful to have me as a brother and she just wanted me to know that she loved me and she was praying for me. Tammy and I had a lot of inside jokes. A lot of you have probably heard them and didn't understand them. One of which I'll cherish forever. Tammy nicknamed me Rudolph. Of course, this was short for Rudolph, the red-nosed reindeer. I forget all of the details, but I remember I was dating Michelle and we were still in the trying to impress each other stage. And I had this massive zit that came out on my nose. Tammy noticed I was being really ridiculous over it. And through her giggling, she walked up beside me and she said, patted me on the shoulder and she said, "Don't worry, Michelle won't even notice, Rudolph." From then on, she referred to me many times as Rudolph. She even saved my number to her phone contacts under the name of Rudolph with a picture of Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. Tammy always had that great sense of humor and was always quick on her feet to poke a joke and to give everybody a laugh. One thing I think everybody in this church building today would agree on is that Tammy seemed to always be there for you at the right moment, never too soon, never too early. She was always right on time. I was always inspired how God used her to minister to so many broken people just by allowing her to stop and pray with somebody. And I dare say, if I were to ask you to raise your hand, if she had prayed with you, probably most of you who worked with Tammy, who are friends with Tammy, who've seen Tammy on a regular basis or went to college with Tammy, you would probably raise your hand because that's just who Tammy was. One thing in particular I will always remember with Tammy is the night my son was born. There was complications and the doctor said Michelle needed emergency C-section. It had been a long 24 hours or so and I was exhausted and scared out of my mind. I remember walking into the hallway to clear my head. In my exhaustion, I just couldn't hold myself up anymore. I remember I was starting to drop down to the floor because I just couldn't stand anymore on my own. In that moment, Tammy had walked up behind me, grabbed me by the arms and lifted me up. She again gave me one of those big hugs as she reassured me everything was going to be okay. And she started praying with me while she was holding me. I thought about this memory of her for the last week. And I thought how blessed we all are to have been given such a friend and family member like Tammy. I couldn't help but think how many times in her life has she been there during someone's weakest moments to help lift them up and remind them of God's perfect love and grace. That's just who God made Tammy to be. Her love for God, along with her loyal, ministering friendship, was a rare jewel to be found. It was grounded deep within her, and it never wavered. She was genuine through and through. It was something everyone cherished in her. Here lately, I've sat for many hours and had several sleepless nights since Tammy's passing. Something I can't get my mind away from is wondering what heaven must be like. I wonder what Tammy is doing at this very moment. And although we may not know what heaven really is like, it makes my mind wonder, is she walking on those beautiful streets of gold? Is she singing along with the angels? Maybe it's time to rejoice for another sinner saved. Or maybe in this very moment, She is at the very feet of Jesus, our Savior. What a glorious thought that is. I'd like to share a conversation, and some of you may have seen my Facebook post the day after Tammy passed. This conversation happened between Michelle and Tammy, and I had overheard a little bit of it, and Michelle had shared a little bit more about it with me. I even questioned Michelle a little bit more here the past couple days because I wanted to know. And Tammy was an older teenager and a young adult. She wanted to do nothing but serve God with everything she had. She would pray and beg God to allow her to be a missionary. It was her greatest desire. Tammy said she eventually accepted that God wanted to use her in a little bit of a different way. As God would have it, he would use Tammy as a missionary, ministering to her friends, loved ones, her students at work, and even to people she hardly knew. At the end of the conversation, Tammy said something that has stuck with me for the last several weeks since I heard this. I'm paraphrasing a little bit, but Tammy said, "I realized in my cancer is my mission field. This is where and how God wants me to minister to people around me, even to my doctors. If I live or if I die, this is the plan God has had for my life all along. I trust his plan, and this is what I have to do. If just one life is changed because of what I'm going through, then it's worth it all. And if I die during the process, then my mission is complete, and God wants me home." This has been so convicting to me on so many levels the past few weeks. To have such a dreaded illness and still be able to shine God's light through it all. What a powerful testimony. Last week, as Alondra had mentioned, we were all together right after we found out. I went to look for Michelle, found her in Tammy's room. And I had walked into the bathroom to get Michelle some tissues, and I found a Bible verse taped on the bathroom mirror in Tammy's room. Hebrews 11:1. "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen." Below that, she had written, "My cancer," and had drawn the heart beside it. She knew God had a reason, a plan, and a purpose for her life. At times, she seemed to be so entirely okay with God's will, it was almost as if she owned it herself in a sense. She had her faith in God and was okay with whatever that was. Because of Tammy, these past few weeks, my faith in God has grown immensely. My perspective on life has been changed. My Christian walk has grown. I've thought for days now how to end this eulogy time. And if I could ask Tammy, what would be the one thing she would want to leave with you? What would it be? And no doubt it would be, first of all, your assurance of salvation and your surrendering to God's perfect will for your life. Here's what Tammy would want me to leave you with. Do you know that you're saved? Do you know without a shadow of a doubt, heaven will be your home? If so, that's great. But are you surrendered to God's perfect will no matter the cost? The pain we are feeling, knowing Tammy, will never be in our earthly presence again, is at times almost unbearable. But we serve a God who is giving fulfilling peace and grace to help in this time of need. And I speak for our entire family when I say that we are solely relying on God's strength and believing that sweet promise that we will see Tammy again in heaven. Now here's the question I want to leave with you, and I know I can hear Tammy telling me to do it right now. Will you be in heaven?
Well, there's no question in my mind that I don't think Tammy's life and memory and her contribution to our lives could have been exemplified or explained or illustrated any better than what has been done. So to God be the glory for that. And you know, as I listened to everybody, I was just looking over the things that were my thoughts as well. James said the same thing. The reason that we're all saying, or that everybody's saying the same thing, is because, like an onion, every layer of Tammy is just the same, all the way to the core. She's just the real deal. And so, praise the Lord for the eulogy. Let's sing.
Okay, if you would, please stand with me. Again, directing yourself to the screen here. We're going to sing 375 for those in live streaming. It is Well With My Soul. A question that we all need to answer. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast brought me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well, it is well with my soul, with my soul, it is well, it is well with my soul. Though Satan should mock it, through trials may come, let this blessed assurance control, that Christ has begun my helpless sustain, and then shed his own blood for my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul, with my soul, it is well, it is well with my soul. My sins, oh, the blessed of the glorious thought, my sin not in part, but the whole is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul, with my soul, it is well.
Okay. James, are you ready?
Physically, but boy.
When you finally make your entrance to that city of jasper walls and bright golden avenues, and as you behold all of its beauty and its splendor, remember, there's just one request I make of you. Look for me, for I will be there too. I realize when you arrive, there'll be so much to view. But after you've been there 10,000 years, a million, or maybe two, look for me, for I will be there too. As you go down your list of first things, there's no question you'll want to see your loved ones waiting there for you. And when you feel you've shared your story with the last one that wants to hear you tell just how you made it through, look for me. Oh, I'd like to hear it too. I realize when you arrive, there'll be so much to view. After you've been there 10,000 years, a million, or maybe two, look for me, for I will be there too. Heaven, it's sounding sweeter all the time. Seems like lately it's always on my mind, and some sweet day I'm gonna leave this old world behind. Yes, heaven, it's sounding sweeter all the time. Look for me, for I will be there too. I realize when you will arrive, there'll be so much to view. But after you've been there 10,000 years, a million, maybe two, look for me, for I will be there too. I will be there too.
Thank you, James, and of course all of you who participated in honoring Tammy's life. I feel like I could just sit here just the rest of the day and sort of bask in the memory of a person, but I want to be careful to say that all that Tammy was and all that she was able to be, as she would quickly agree, was because of God who lived inside of her. And so by our effort to honor her and her memory and celebrate her life, in essence, we certainly want to lift up the Lord. But you know, at a time like this, it's after we have celebrated the life and memory of someone that's gone on to heaven for us, the rest of the time here together is for us in truth. I thought about Ecclesiastes chapter number 7. The preacher said it's better to go to the house of mourning than to the house of feasting, for that is the end of all men. The house of mourning would be the place that we're in today. It's better to go to the house of mourning than to go to the house of feasting, for that, the house of mourning, is the end of all men. And the preacher said, and the living will lay it to his heart. Some may say, why do we do what we do beyond trying to remember the person we love so much as they've made their journey to heaven? Well, the reason that we do this is because God has said the exemplary testimony of somebody that's gone on before us to heaven is supposed to make a profound impact on our lives if we'll let it, and it will if we'll let it. I believe it was August 26th, Wednesday, if I've got the days wrong, I apologize, when Tammy got the news from Dr. Murphy that she had only 3 weeks to a month to live. I talked to her once, and then we talked again. It was before prayer meeting that evening. I was really burdened about how to share things like that with the church, because I only wanted to do what Tammy said I could do. I didn't want to just do it the wrong way. And so when we were talking that night before prayer meeting, I asked her what she wanted me to tell the church. Her answer for me was the sum total, in my opinion, of who Tammy was, or maybe a better way to put that is who God had made Tammy to become. Her answer as a sum total for me, here's what she said. Pastor, just tell them what we know. And then she said, this is his story, not mine. Since that conversation, I've been reminded of a truth that must forever be preeminent in our lives and in our walk with God. I mean, from the beginning to, well, this certainly is not the end, but of our physical life. Like one of our favorite hymns, Living by Faith, it's called. Romans chapter 1, verse 17 says, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. As a matter of fact, I struggled because there is so much that certainly could be said that's helpful. My mind ran to James chapter 1, I believe it is, where James is talking about the idea of works and how essential it is. That our faith without works, he said, is dead, being alone. But he made a remarkable statement to me, or in the word there, it was remarkable to me. He said, I will show you my faith. Hear this. I will show you my faith by my works. I will show you my faith by how I live. Can I say to you today, to me, that's the sum total of Tammy McEldowney's life. She showed us her faith by her life. Can I just say, God help us, every single one of us who name the name of Christ, to make that our goal in this life. May it become preeminent that we will live our life in a way that it will reveal our faith. She lived the life we all need to live. When I think about her faith, and I'm not going to spend as much time as we had originally planned, because there's really just one or two thoughts, I think, that have just really been permeated me about this matter of Tammy and her faith. But as I consider the faith that Tammy revealed or was able to show by her life, the right definition for that faith needs to be considered. An intense personal trust and reliance on Christ. Now watch this. For everything. Not just some things. When I think of Tammy, as these things have all been said, words that come to my mind like strength. And I'm going to say inner strength. It was supernatural because it was God. I think of encouragement, Kermit. Everybody has talked about this. I think about ministry. What a great burden she had for people that were saved. Time and time and time again, calling her after church, just checking on her because she couldn't be here. I don't know, there was ever a conversation we didn't have. She'd say, Pastor, did anybody get saved today? And how it seemed to thrill her heart when we're able to say yes. Others, yes, others, Lord. May this my motto be. Ministry and others come to my mind. I mean, even when she didn't feel good, you've heard this. It didn't seem like she wanted to talk about that. She was always trying to find out how other people were. Here's a word. And I think God might have helped her master this. The word is empathy. The word means to be able to identify with people in their need and connect with them. And James said, hold them up. It was a dark time in our life. A few years ago, we hadn't shared it with anybody. It had to do with my oldest son. Mostly Boone was on the phone constantly with him, going through this with him best we could Sunday morning. You go to church even when things are hard, don't you? But you can't always wipe this away, can you? So Boone was bearing the She was bearing the burden that day, probably more so than me because of ministry. Well, as was the case, Tammy had a discernment. It wasn't really a sense. It was just the Spirit of God. She had discernment. And she found Boone out on the front porch. I don't know if
Boone had to leave or whatever, talking to David. But anyway, she did what she always does. She hugged Boone, prayed with her. I wish someday you'd ask Boone how it made her feel. She had the ability to connect in a way that only the Spirit of God could do through us. And may God help me to be that kind of a Christian. Matter of fact, I overheard somebody say, I don't even know who said it, Kermit, you don't have to, you can tell me later if you want, but somebody, I overheard somebody say something about, there was something unusually good about Tammy's hugs. I can tell you what it was. I can tell you what it was. It was God using her in that empathetic ministry to help you feel good. And then there was this joy. Yes, her smile was infectious. I used to kid her about it being fake. I'm serious. I've watched her hold that face for 30 minutes. Not even, I've watched her. I mean, it looked plastic. I mean, it did. I told her over and over again. She said, it's real. I believe it was. I think she just had the can't help it's, right? And then here's something. She was thankful. She was really thankful. Do you know Thanksgiving is something you can only give if you have it? Saying thanks doesn't mean you're thankful. But Tammy was thankful. And here's I wrote this down because as many of you did, talking on the phone to Tammy, she would say, God is good all the time. She'd have to put the phone down to throw up. I'm not saying that to be humorous. She had to put the phone down and say, excuse me for a minute, throw up, and then come back and say, God is good all the time. She's thankful. I agree, though, with, I don't know, so many folks have said so much, whoever it was, though I don't think, I'm not sure how she'd feel right now about all this to-do being made over her. I want to make sure that I say this, that it was not in any way Tammy in and of herself doing anything that she did. Oh, she was a good gal, good character, a great person. But the stuff that made the difference, the stuff that made her who she was, that was God. That was God in her and through her, and to God be the glory. Great things he has done. She was forever concerned in all that she did that God would always get all of the glory. Remember what she said. This is his story, Pastor, not mine. I'll never forget that. I believe that all of it's possible because of that one of my first thought, and that is about her faith. 7 years old, she started her faith journey by trusting Christ to be her Savior. Can I tell you that's where it all begins for everybody? That's where it begins for everybody. You will never do anything easier than to get saved. But there will never be anything take place in your life so profound and monumental and life-changing as when you trust Christ as your Savior. I don't plead with people to do a lot, but I would plead with you today, not because Tammy wants you to. Can I tell you that everybody from probably in this room, she loved you and all of us as much as she could, but I can tell you Jesus loves you more than Tammy does. Believe the gospel. God said he loved you enough to send his son. He came to this earth, he lived, and he died on the cross in your place and mine. On the cross, he bore your sins and mine. He paid our sin debt. He died. They took him off. Joseph of Arimathea begged the body of Jesus from Pilate. They took his body off the cross.
They fixed his body as custom would provide. And they placed his body in a borrowed tomb. Was a good idea. He wasn't going to be there long, right? 3 days approximately, he got up out of the grave. God raised him from the dead. He was here for a while, then he ascended back to heaven. And right now, listening to every word we say, he sits on the right hand of the Father, making intercession for the saints. Here is the task for everyone who wants to be saved. Believe the gospel. That God loved you, gave his son in your place to die for you, be buried, and he rose again from the dead. Believe it. When Tammy was 7, she believed it. Verse 13 of Romans chapter 10 says that after we believe the gospel, all we have to do is to call out on the name of the Lord. It literally ask him to save you. And you know what he'll do? Just exactly what he said he would do. That's where it all begins. What an incredible song. You ought to get it and put it on your phone, listen to it for days. That's where faith steps in. Incredible. Because of this life of faith and dependency upon God, and here's the point that I wanted to say, I think that might separate Tammy a little bit in experience. Stay with me. I'm not going to be long, I promise. See, some of us get really hung up in this matter of faith and more the product than the person. In other words, more what God could do than God himself. And what I've discovered about Tammy in our conversations is that, she believed and she prayed in the possibility. There's no question she believed like we all believed. Ephesians chapter 3 says that God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we could ask or think. Amen. He can. There is nothing that God cannot do. I personally believe, though I wasn't with her in her prayer closet, I wasn't with her all the time. But what is indicative of every testimony she gives, no matter if she writes it on the mirror or on a phone or on a piece of paper, is this. Not only did she pray that God would heal her, but she prayed that God would have his way in her life. She submitted to him. And so, in reality, she did believe God could, but I'll tell you, what I don't know if the word impress is right, I don't know. Convicting is what it is for me, I think. But in terms of watching Tammy live and express her faith, it was more that total dependency and reliance upon him, his will, his perfect plan. Whatever God allows, she was committed to this. I'm happy with whatever God does. How many times she said, whether I live or I die, whether I live or I die, whether I live or I die, may God use my testimony to glorify himself and help others get to Jesus Christ. Wow. And because of that, Kermit, I think, you know, you mentioned, you read back 2013-14. This thing that was in Tammy, the thing she lived, it didn't just start when she got sick. That's obvious. But you know what it did do for her? Watch. It helped carry her through. I mean, she was no different after the diagnosis than she was before. She was just full of God. God's hand was on her. He lived inside of her like he lives in all of us who are saved. And so as she focused not so much on the product, and I think, can I just say to you that while God is able, and sometimes he does exactly what we want him to do, all of us probably could raise our hands to that. Can I go ahead and just tell you, it's not always going to be that way. Yes? But that doesn't mean God is not faithful. That doesn't mean God is not able. That doesn't mean that doesn't mean that he doesn't love us, or that he loves us any less. There are times, matter of fact, I think all the time, he would rather us trust him as a person than trust him for what he can do. And this, I think, is what Tammy was able to have. The demonstration of her faith, it convicted me, not because of her, what she believed God could do. It was way more than that. It was that ability to say with that smile, and this is the thing, it wasn't fake, it was real. When she said, it's okay, you would believe that it's okay with her. It's okay. Because her faith was in God. And so that faith, that dependency upon God and the strength and hope that comes from it, with that, she was able to embrace this part of God's perfect plan for her life. So, in life or death, she said, I want people to come to Christ. It doesn't matter to me. If it did matter to her, and I think that Angie said this, if it did matter, it was more about you than it was about her. If she wanted to stay, it was more about everybody else. But here's what she wanted. She wanted people to come to Christ so they could have what she had, forgiveness of sin. She wanted folks to know Jesus, not just as a Savior, but she wanted them to know him as a friend. She wanted them to have a home in heaven with Jesus and her. So think about it, Dorothy, just a few moments ago, or a few days ago, when Tammy left here, she opened her eyes in the presence of the Lord. Therefore, we are always confident, Paul said, knowing that whilst we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith and not by sight. We are confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. I've always been amazed at the definition or the idea of that word present. It simply means to be among one's own people. It means to be home. And I'm just going to read this little poem here as I close this today. You may know it as lyrics to a song called Finally Home. Originally, it was a poem written by Robert E. Sell, and it was entitled Think. He said, think of stepping on shore and finding it heaven, of taking hold of a hand and finding it God's hand, of breathing new air and finding it celestial air, of feeling invigorated and finding it immortality, of passing from storm and tempest to an unbroken calm, of waking up and finding yourself home. I don't know, James. I know that I know that it's way better than anything this world can offer. When you think about heaven. And you know, our sorrow, which is right, it is godly, is different, though. If we know Christ, it is different than those who have no hope. It just simply means that here, on this day, okay, on this day, we are not really saying farewell. We could actually say, I'll see you again. And can I just hasten to say that because of the uncertainty and the brevity of life, you could see her tomorrow. Or not. If you're not prepared. Here's what we know for sure. There is only one way to heaven. Right? Jesus said, I am the way. Truth and life, only one. This is the part that's always stood out to me. And no man boy or girl or woman, cometh unto the Father but by me. If you and I get to go to heaven when we die, it's going to be, we're going to go the way Jesus told us to go. And very simply, I've said it already, just like Tammy did when she was 7 years old. I wish I could have been there just to hear. I know I'm a sinner. And because of that, I know I need a Savior. And not just anybody will do. But God gave me what I needed in Jesus. He lived and died, was buried, and rose again at 7 years old. Tammy said, I believe that. And she probably said something like, Dear Jesus, come into my heart and save me. But it wasn't the words that saved her. It was her faith in the gospel. But she sealed the deal that day at 7 when she asked Christ to save her. So that when this day comes, she closes her eyes here. She wakes up in glory. And now, she's just waiting to see you and me. Someday, maybe sooner for others than some, you'll have your opportunity for this. And I'm going to say with Tammy, boy, please don't ignore the opportunity to trust Christ as Savior. So here's what we're going to do. I think it'd be what Tammy would want, but more importantly than that, again, I'm going to tell you, nobody loves you like Jesus does. He's the one who died, right? So here's what I'm going to ask you. If you died right now, you don't even have to look down right now. You can look at me. If you died right now or tomorrow, let's say, are you absolutely certain that you'd go to heaven? I want you to think about that for a minute. If you're not sure, I want to remind you of what Ecclesiastes said. Our gathering together today, while to honor Tammy's life, maybe even more importantly, is about your soul and about whether or not you'll let Tammy's life and the influence of the gospel affect you like he wants it to. So here's what we're going to do. If you couldn't say yes, I'm just going to ask you quietly to repeat a prayer after me. And then we're going to be done. Okay? Let's bow for prayer. Just repeat after me. And remember that it's not the words that you pray. It's your faith in the gospel. Dear Lord Jesus, I believe with all of my heart that you loved me and you died for me on the cross. That they buried you and on the third day, God raised you from the dead. I believe that with all of my heart. I know I'm a sinner. I need you to be my Savior. Will you please save me, forgive me, and make me a child of God today? So that when I die, I can know without a doubt that heaven will be my home, where I will see Jesus and I will see Tammy and all those that have gone on before me. Thank you for dying for me. Thank you for saving me. In Jesus' name I pray. Now before you raise your head, I just wonder, is there anybody in this room that would say, Pastor, I prayed that prayer and I meant it with all my heart. Would you raise your hand just to make that testimony clear? Anybody? Amen. Good. You can put your hand down. Somebody? Oh, yes, ma'am, sir. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am. I prayed it. Oh, yes, ma'am, up here. I meant it with all my heart.
Anybody else? Anybody else? Okay. Dear Father, as we bow in your presence, Lord, we are humbled, I think is the right word, in this place today. And incredibly thankful for your goodness to us. And Lord, we're thankful most of all that you love us and that you gave Jesus to die in our place so that we could know that when we die, heaven would be our home. We're so thankful, Lord, for a life like Tammy's. Thankful for her submission, her faith, how that she trusted you. You spoke to her, you led her, you gave her confidence, you gave her peace, and in essence, you said, Tammy, it's going to be okay. You can trust me. And she did. And I'm so thankful that we were able to see that. And I pray for those of us, Lord, that know you personally and that you know us, we're saved, that we'll leave this place today, Lord, contemplating allowing that kind of life to make us better in answer to Tammy's prayer and certainly what you desire in our life as well. Please be with Kermit and Dorothy and the whole family. Comfort as only you can. May they understand your presence, Lord, like they never have before. And we'll thank you for what you do. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said. Amen. Now we've got a treat. Okay? We have one more speaker. And let's do that now, and then we'll sing and we'll be done.
Tammy's life physically, but boy, is he using her testimony ever, day by day. And so take a moment, if you would, Tammy, please.
All right, just to tell you guys, God's so good, because let me tell you, getting up here, I always get nervous every time. I don't know why. I get comfortable, you would think, but no, I can't. But you know what? I can't sit still and be quiet. I just have to tell everybody how amazing my God is. And you know, one thing that the Lord really put in my heart, and I'll tell you, a couple of you guys are new, you may not know my whole story, so I'm going to kind of tell you a little bit, but just as you're listening to this story and how God has worked in my life since January, just imagine when you go out in this world, because we're all in the same thing with this whole COVID, and it's terrifying when we got the world around us and we're trying to decide, is it safe to come to church? Is it safe to go to the store? Where can you go? It's very discouraging, and I understand that because I'm going through that with my circumstances, but I understand how all you guys could feel the same way, and it's overwhelming sometimes, but you know, the one thing I can tell you is that God is in control. This wasn't an accident. Right. He knew this was going to happen. He knew that all of us were going to be here, the time that we were, and the end time, and it's our job to keep witnessing to other people and not get afraid and stay in our homes. And that's a hard thing, because today when I found out, because my niece went to camp, and I found out about the COVID thing, and there could be, have been, and I thought, oh, Lord, what should I do? And then God just kept telling me, why all of a sudden now are you going to be scared to go to church? Now you should trust me, because you've been trusting me the whole time. So I just have to be encouraging to all of you guys as you're going through this whole time like everybody else. So let me tell you a little bit about myself. Some of you guys don't know. In January 27th, I was diagnosed with small cell carcinoma of the ovaries. And if you look it up, there is no one that has survived it. 300 people have been diagnosed with it. If you were stage one, you might have a couple months to live, maybe to a year. I was diagnosed with stage four. It went to my liver. It was extremely aggressive. And within 1 week of getting a scan in January into February, my cancer grew significantly in my liver. I was very, very sick and didn't know I was dying. The Lord just constantly kept opening doors left and right. I was able to get help with no insurance, and God just blessed so much. So that happened. So I'm just going to kind of speed up a little bit. I had a tumor on my left ovary that was cancerous. I was able to have a surgery after they lifted it with COVID. When they went in, I signed off for a whole hysterectomy. I am 34 years old, have never been married, and have children. That's my greatest joy. So when I had to sign that paper to have all that gone forever, I never, ever dreamed that God would let me keep it. when I went in, they kept saying, you know, you might lose some of your bowel, you might have more cancer than you when we open you up. And I kept thinking, okay, I'm going to get through this. I woke up, they only took my left ovary, and that was it. I had no cancer anywhere else. So the Lord just constantly is opening up doors and blessing me constantly. So another thing I want to praise the Lord for, so I had the surgery in May. I'm feeling amazing today. Everybody keeps asking me how I'm feeling, and I'm just being honest, completely honest. I don't feel like I have cancer right now at all. I do not. I do feel my liver every once in a while, so keep that in prayer. I don't know if that's the chemo working or is that growing again, but you know what? Everybody keeps asking me, how are you doing? And I can truly tell you that I am thankful for these last couple weeks that God has given me, that I feel normal again. And you know what? If God takes this and this cancer comes back and takes me, that's okay, because God has a reason for this whole thing. And I'm just thanking Him for the good time that I have had. So just keep praying for that. I just went and saw my OBGYN. She's a specialist. And they were reminding me again about my case is so rare that I keep going before that. It's called tumor board. So multiple doctors see my case. And I already should have, let me back up a little bit. My doctor, when she first diagnosed me with what I have, only said I had a couple months to live. And that was back in February. I shouldn't be here today. And if I was, I should be in hospice right now. And I don't look like that now, do I? Praise God. So that's all from the Lord. And so they reminded me again that I have a scan at the end of this month. A CT scan, so we'll find out what that cancer is doing, and it's going before the board again. And I just keep praying that if it's God's will, He will heal me 100% from a cancer that is non-curable. There is no fix for it, and I'm just praying that God's glory will shine through for everybody. And it's not me. Some people always say, you're my hero. I really don't like that, because here's why. I'm a sinner and I struggle, and I have down days, and there's days I just get real discouraged and I don't understand why, but God just keeps encouraging me. And I feel like a David. I feel like there's days I go down and come up, but not everybody sees those days. And I'm just like all of you guys, and every one of you guys can be exactly where I am, because God has a plan for you. And this COVID thing and the world's losing their mind. We all have something in our lives that we're going through, and God's putting you on your own platform. And, you know, it's up to you. If you keep getting in God's word, and God will give you the strength to continue to shine for Him during our time. So I have a doctor's appointment August 4th. I'll get my scan before that. So just please pray that the Lord will still continue to be glorified. If He does choose to make me go through chemo the second time, just keep please praying that the Lord will continue to give me the strength that He needs, that I will continue to keep shining for Him. Because chemo, it's hard. It's really hard. But you know what? God's going to give it to me. If that's His will, He's going to help me through this. And that's what my prayer is. So another thing, Miss Pat even told me, somebody's watching my case, and hopefully, Lord willing, they're going to get saved. And that's my prayer. I told it to Pastor when I first got diagnosed in the hospital, and I finally had months to live at 33 years old. I said, if one person gets saved, it'll be worth all of it. And that's my prayer. And so far, I haven't heard of anyone getting saved. That doesn't mean it hasn't happened. So please keep praying, because that would be my one goal. And that the Lord will keep my eyes on Him. That no matter how many times I'm throwing up, or I'm discouraged, or I'm going through something, that the Lord will help me continue to keep my eyes on Him. Because it's not me. It's only from God. And I just want to thank you all for your encouraging words and your prayer. Please don't quit, because I'm a testimony that prayer works. And that God isn't finished with me yet. And all of you guys and what you're going through right now today, hey, He's got a plan for us all. And I know the world feels very scary, but you know what? If you're saved, you're going to heaven. And one day we're going to get away from all this mess, and we get to go to heaven, and there won't be any more. So I just hope it's a blessing to all of you.
Yeah. Well, we failed to say the Lord did answer our prayer. She is cured completely. And to God be the glory. So she got the best of both, didn't she? Got to go to heaven, and what a blessing that is. And by the way, I don't know how many, there were several folks today that prayed and asked Christ to save them. So to God be the glory for that. Amen. All right, stand together. We're going to sing two verses of When We All Get to Heaven. And then I'm going to ask Brother Mel Spiker if he would to come and close in prayer. And then Jim will come and take the service.
Tammy's message to us is stay in God's word. So that's what we all need to do. Stay in God's word, no matter what. Okay, for now, those watching, it's 4:29. when we all get to heaven, verses 1 and 4 of this great hymn. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace in the mansions bright and blessed. He'll prepare for us a place when we all get to heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us. Soon his beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open. We shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day.
Heavenly Father, we are truly blessed today. Yes, because of Tammy's life, but even more so because of who you are and who you are and were in her. Father, I ask on behalf of those that have trusted Jesus Christ as their Savior today that you would seal it within their hearts.
Amen.
And that today they would begin to grow and to nurture that faith in you.
Amen.
And that they would become a testimony and a witness of your love, yet even extended to them.
Amen.
Father, we pray for those that are saved, that each of us would have been encouraged today, that our faith would be challenged to surrender to you even more than what we are and allow you to write our story, the story of our lives, that you would write it as you would see fit.
Amen.
And we would become surrendered to it.
Amen.
And God, as we begin to dismiss and to go our separate ways and yet have the graveside and so many things yet to go on, God, that you would just stir us, strengthen us, Father, that we would know of your presence, your power. And Lord, as you said to Paul, that your grace is sufficient, may we truly rely upon your grace for whatever our need is in our heart and life at this time. We ask these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
When you call on one who you cannot see, and you give him your heart for all eternity, that's when faith begins. When you turn away from all your sin and you trust him, the Lord, to cleanse you within, that's when faith begins. In childlike trust, you hold out your hand, simply believing salvation. Steps in.
Sunny days, that the sky above us would never turn gray. But life isn't always sunshine. We have times that leave us asking why. And when the clouds roll in and tears begin to fall, there must be a reason for it all.
Redeemer of the rain, the Lord will never waste our pain. He brings beauty out of brokenness and hope to our heartache.
Healing out of every hurt that invades our shattered world.
We never walk through trials in vain.
Redeemer of the
country where no trees. is tomorrow, because he lives. All fear is gone, because I know he holds a future, and life is worth the living just because he lives.
God sent his son, they called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives.
And then one day
is worth living just because he lives.
We pray for blessings, we pray for peace, comfort for family, protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, for prosperity. We pray for your mighty hand to ease our suffering. Spoken need, yet love is way too much to give us lesser things. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? We pray for wisdom, your voice to hear, and we cry in anger when we cannot feel you near. We doubt your goodness. doubt your love, as if every promise from your word is not enough. Nights, all your mercies in disguise.